you just heard my name is Nicole, and what I'd like is to hear all of your names. So on the count of three, can you tell me your name? Ready? One, two, three. You guys are so compliant. That's awesome. So if I was trying to hear if there was another Nicole here, how would I solve that problem? I want to tell you how that problem is an analog for a problem that I'm trying to solve now that took me to a bat cave in China and will hopefully help us control teams of underwater vehicles one day. So I'm an engineer and I study distributed systems. Distributed systems are systems that are made up of many elements that interact to accomplish a task together. So here's an example. If I have a problem, I can have one computer solve it, or I can have a lot of computers solve it all together. And if they work together, presumably they'll be able to solve the problem faster. But the question becomes, how do I control their interactions? How do they talk to each other? I can have one guy be in charge and tell everyone what to do and then bring the answers together and tell them to me, or I can make their interactions more complex. And the cool thing is, if I design these interactions well, the system can be resilient to the failure of one of the computers. So if one guy dies, the job still gets done. And this is really nice as an engineer. We call this robustness. So systems like this are really robust to failure. So we use distributed systems to make solutions for a lot of different problems. For example, wireless sensor networks that you can see would monitor an environment like a forest, or teams of underwater vehicles that would explore the ocean and build maps. I study how to control systems like this, but I don't do it from an entirely engineering or mathematical perspective. I like to take inspiration from systems that are already really good at doing this type of collaborative behavior, which are animal groups. So I'm sure you're familiar with fish schools and bird flocks. They move in these really cool patterns. And the interesting feature about them is that there's not one guy in charge. They just look at the guys next to them, and they make these simple interactions based on these local information. But you get this overarching or global pattern that just emerges. And among these groups, the group that I say is actually even more singular, more unique. And that group is bat swarms. So bats are unique for a lot of reasons. They're mammals and they fly. The uniqueness that I'm interested in is in their sensing. So many species of bats use echolocation or sonar to sense the world around them. They make a sound, they listen for the echo, and they build a map of their environment just based on the echoes on obstacles. But when the bats live in a large group, which many species of bats do, they'll live in a colony of a million members, which is super impressive. When they use this type of sensing in a large group, it becomes a much more complicated problem. So here's an example of one bat echolocating. Shift it down so you can hear it. So it's pretty straightforward. Here's like 15 bats. So it gets intense pretty quickly. And if you look at this picture, that's well more than 15, right? So now if you're in a colony of a million members, the question is, how do you know the echo of your sound is the echo that you're hearing? It's like the question of, how do I know if I hear Nicole in a group of a bunch of other names? How do you solve that problem? That problem is called jamming, and that's a problem that plagues bats, or should plague bats, and also any engineered system that uses sensing like bats, like sonar for those underwater vehicles. We call this type of sensing active sensing. So it's sensing that relies on generating a signal, it interacts with the world around it, and it comes back to you. So sonar does this with sound, LiDAR does it with light, radar does it with radio frequency, and this is in direct contrast to passive sensing like vision, where you take in a signal like light from the world around you. So engineered systems with active sensing, they suffer from jamming, and so a lot of times in solutions, like a distributed system that uses this sensing, you would just have everyone behave independently. You wouldn't have any interaction. But from what the bats do, when we see in the laboratory, it seems like they're actually interacting. So what we see is that when bats are being jammed, they actually have these behaviors to accommodate the jamming. So they'll change their frequency to better distinguish the sounds. They'll just be quiet for a while. And what's really interesting is that when they're flying together in pairs through a maze, they seem to echolocate less on average. And so that tells us they may actually be collaborating to build those maps of the world around them. So that's something that could be really cool to implement in an engineered system, because it could save us energy on sensing. And saving energy is huge, right? So what I'm trying to do with my research group is to understand what the bats do to inspire control algorithms for groups of engineered systems that would use this type of sensing. So here's how we do it. We have a couple different perspectives. First, we want to know what the bats do, so you have to figure out a way to understand that, because you can't talk to them. You can't ask them, are you interacting? So we went to this bat cave in China, which is beautiful, with a couple thousand bats that live in it, and we filmed them as they fly out using thermal or infrared light. So the question that we wanted to answer was, are they even interacting? This is not necessarily known. And it was, to me, I wasn't quite sure if they were interacting. But when we filmed them going through this obstacle course that we built, we found that information flows from the guy in front to the guy behind, or it seems to flow this way, just by mathematically analyzing their trajectories. So it says, okay, it looks like they're interacting. So now we can build bat-inspired rules into mathematical models of bats that would move together, bats. And we can study these numerically. What we found by studying these models is that bats, when they interact together, are able to better avoid obstacles using interaction than behaving independently. So it tells us that the question is well posed. This is a good thing to try and do. So now we're building robotic systems that have custom sonar sensors that allow this type of interception of sensing signals. And we want to build some bat-inspired rules into their interaction and be able to test hypotheses about engineered systems. So what we really want to do is take inspiration from the bats and then use it to inspire solutions in an engineered system, like teams of underwater vehicles. When you have teams of underwater vehicles to go collect climate data or ocean data, they go out for a really long time. So saving energy on sensing would be really huge in terms of getting much larger data sets. But the cool thing about taking inspiration from a biological system, a bio-inspired system, is that we actually get the opportunity to learn something about the bats when we study the engineering system or the mathematical model. And this can allow us to interact both with the bats and the engineered system at the same time. For example, I don't know if you know, but wind turbines kill bats disproportionately as compared to other animals, and we're not really sure why. And so if we can learn about how the bats interact with each other, the opportunity is there to actually engineer systems that are good for both the humans and then the animals that inspire us as well. Thank you.